Magnolia Grove, The Story of Rear Admiral Richmond Pearson Hobson by Dr. Harvey Rosenfeld. Prologue. Santiago de Cuba, June 3, 1898. Valiente, valiente. It was early in the morning, just past daybreak, near the entrance of Santiago Harbor. Just minutes before, the eight men floating on the small catamaran, all that remained of the dilapidated old collier Merrimac they had just succeeded in intentionally sinking, were readying themselves to die. They had seen the squad of riflemen on the Spanish launch they were hailing form into a semicircle. They had heard them shout the dreaded instructions, "Load, ready, aim." "The miserable cowards," Lieutenant Richmond Pearson Hobson, senior officer of the crew, had thought bitterly. "A brave nation will hear of this and call for an account." But no account was to be reckoned, for the command to fire was never voiced. A most distinguished-looking and elegantly dressed Spanish admiral and two of his junior officers leaned out of their cabin and called the firing squad off. Lieutenant Hobson responded by quickly removing his revolver belt, glasses, canteen, and life preserver, and surrendering himself and his crew. Their nearly suicidal mission to block the Spanish fleet had not succeeded as hoped. The rescue plan did not materialize as planned, and now they had no choice but to turn themselves over to the enemy. The Spaniards looked on in amazement as Rear Admiral Contra-Almirante Cervera y Topete pulled the strikingly handsome American naval officer and his seven crew members out of the water. Who were these Americans, dressed only in long woolen underwear with revolvers and life belts strapped under their stomachs, that had dared to execute and nearly successfully complete such a suicidal mission? Their astonishment turned quickly to civility, kindness, and outright praise as they chanted in unison, applauding the Merrimac crew's act of courage, "Valiente, valiente." Lavish praise notwithstanding, Richmond Pearson Hobson and the Merrimac men were now prisoners of the Spanish military, on their way to incarceration at Morro Castle. Chapter 1. Something to Say for Heredity. Under Providence, some have the privilege of dying, others the privilege of living for country and humanity. Those who die have a simpler part. "Those of us who live must make good our part," writes Hobson in his In Line of Duty. So live the Hobson family, priding itself in its roots. While one Hobson ancestor placed the first British flag on New Zealand soil, another fought for American independence from the British in the Revolutionary War. Each made good his part. James Marcellus Hobson was born in 1840, the son of a planter. When he was 21 years old, having graduated from the University of North Carolina, he enlisted as a private in the Confederate Army. Despite being wounded during the Battle of Malvern Hill and again at the Battle of Chancellorsville, he continued fighting, rising to first lieutenant before he was wounded again at the Battle of Spotsylvania. This time he was captured, and for the 14 remaining months of the war, Lieutenant James Hobson was a prisoner. Returning home following his release, Hobson began reading law under North Carolina State Chief Justice Richmond Mumford Pearson. When Justice Pearson retired from the bench and settled in the North Carolina hills, young James was one of a select group of prodigies for whom Pearson built a series of cabins. To the good fortune of our country, it was more than a legal education James acquired by studying with Pearson. His admission to the bar in 1867 was followed closely by marriage to his mentor's daughter. The union of Sarah Croom Pearson and James Hobson, which brought together two of Carolina's most illustrious families, would lead to the birth of an American hero. Magnolia Grove, 1863 to 1882.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.